You saved my again.
What's this?
A local. Let's get out of here before more droids show up.
Jar Jar is a key character in episode one, and he actually was one of the hardest for us. In the sense that he was going to be our really, you know, one of the first pure all-digital characters in a major motion picture. But that aside, you know, design-wise, George has something very specific in mind.
You may be able to take that line, which is sort of somewhere right in here, and go.
George came to me with the character and basically said, he's amphibious, he's tall, he means well, but he's always putting his foot in his mouth, and he's like a combination of Charles Chaplin and Danny Kaye and all those kind of slapstick comedians that ever happened. He's a combination of duck-billed dinosaur and emu, basically, is about the best way I can describe him, with the skin texture of an amphibian and the color pattern of a parrotfish.
And so we started really thinking about, okay, well, what are the things that, you know, we would kind of like to see? And we decided to give him different proportions so that he would walk funny. He would have a slightly different gait. So we gave his, you know, his proportion from his knee to his foot was a little bit longer than normal. It's something that's very subtle, but it gave him a really gangly type of walk.
Well, first of all, the ratite birds, which includes the ostriches and the emus and the rheas and the cassowaries, or when they walk, their necks go kind of this bump, 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 and then they kind of have this, I'd have to get up and demonstrate it, but and the way, just even if you see a chicken walk, it's funny. It just is humorous, but it's graceful at the same time. I wanted to give that to this character.
We shall make you Bombard General.
General. Originally, Jar Jar had short ears, and George thought, well, how about if he had long, floppy ears? You know, they might be really funny if when he turns his head, the ears flop around. And so we did that, and actually, you know, it was one of those things where it's like, wow, that works. And then George, of course, wanted him to be very expressive. And so we thought, okay, well, what's expressive? You know, what can we do with the eyes to make them very comedic? And we thought, okay, well, they should be on stalks so they can pop out. They could do all these things. Gave him a big mouth so he could do wild, crazy expressions. And so all those things, all those pieces started to sort of blend together into creating who Jar Jar is now.
Steady, steady.
The biggest thing was finally was coming up with that concept drawing that George said, yeah, that's him. And then I did orthographics, all the side, the front, the backside, the skeleton, the muscles. My background is vertebrate zoology and paleontology, and that was my training. And so basically, I look at nature, what has gone before, whether it's a prehistoric species or a current species, blend those together, how do those anatomies work in real time and in real life? People that I think were the hardcore Star Wars fans may have had a problem simply because he was new and because he was kind of a funny one. But children loved him.
We see the Federation battleship right at the beginning of the film. It's the opening sequence. And traditionally in the other Star Wars films, we always used to see a Star Destroyer. They were playing around with different ideas for it, and one of them was a saucer, a really large saucer that was kind of detailed sort of like a Star Destroyer, and that it had a trench around the outer edge that had all the little details and things that we've seen on the Star Destroyers in the past. And they had a little inset top and bottom. So that was one idea, and another idea was kind of a ring. And the idea was that this ring had kind of claws, four claws that would hold a sphere inside this thing. So it was like a donut with a tennis ball sitting in it. And Doug did a couple of concept drawings that were the version that we've got, where it's kind of got the opening and it's got the ball. And initially the idea, I think, was that the ball could rotate on the end of the neck that was inside so that the body could swing around and the ball would remain stationary. And there are two different versions of it. There's kind of the standard ship, and then there's another ship that's the command ship that has a tremendous array of antennas and things attached to it. And that was executed as both an 8-foot model and then also a much, much larger surface section. The model, I think, was probably like 20 feet by 30 feet.
We did make close-up sections of it. There's a scene where some ships are flying through its antennas areas, and so we'd have to make big versions of what, you know, take a little bit piece on the ship and make it, you know, 12 feet across. And so we did a lot of that, sections, large sections. We had some moving guns. They were motion control movement guns, so that was kind of neat.
There's a certain level of detail that's done initially, and then you get the thing out on set, and the camera's coming right up on a section of it, and you have to go in and just very delicately detail out to the best of your ability to make this thing look huge. You know, you're doing whatever you can. It's always a cheat, but you're trying to go in there and put enough detail on it to make it look huge.
We had to light that model up from the inside with custom fluorescent lighting and little holes in the paint scheme to make a scale of the lights look small and consequently make the model look big. That was a very difficult one to build because of its shape, and it got heavy. It got really heavy.
That thing was a monster. There's more metal in that than there is in my car. It's really amazing to go from being on stage with this big hunk of plastic and then to see it in the film where it's actually, you know, it's drifting above a planet and there are little lights blinking and all this stuff's happening. And, you know, like I said, there's sort of this magical process between what you were working with on stage and what's in the film. The Republic Cruiser is the ship that we see at the beginning of Episode 1. It kind of comes down and descends into the Federation battleship. And then shortly after that, they destroy it inside the hangar bay. It blows up. I've been through this a number of times where they blow up. And when I first started in the model shop, everybody used to joke that what they should do with the new people is they should have them build something and just let them just work on it until it's just perfect. And when they finally got it where everything's just the way they want it, they should have to put it on the floor and jump up and down on it and smash it. Just to kind of get you in that mode of we're going to blow it up. And the first couple times we blew things up, it's kind of hard. But after a while, you start building them and you realize that's what they're you're building it just to blow it up.
We've littered it up, you know, with, you know, hits relatively big enough to, you know, destroy the model. Probably about the first 6 inches.
The success of any kind of a pyrotechnic explosion on a model is based on how the size of the flames and explosives play against the model. If the model's too small, then the flames look really funny. And, you know, they compensate it with high-speed photography. But sometimes we can do some really great miniature explosions that help us out a lot.
Roll camera.
The concept model, I think, was probably about 22, 23 inches long. And then we built one for production that we used on set that was about 8 feet long. We had one hero model that had operational landing gear and internal lighting and everything. And then we had three pyro ones that we used for the scene where it blows up. It did kind of harken back to the original Star Wars films in terms of the look. It and the Federation battleship both had kind of that same surface detail. The hull plating had little notches in it and kind of the same level of little greeblies and things like that. So it was really fun to make that one because it really did go back to the original Star Wars look.
I'm ambassador to the Supreme Chancellor. I'm taking these people to Coruscant.
Coruscant, that doesn't compute. You're under arrest.
Designing the battle droid was a real collaborative effort. Doug Chang and the other artists would come up with designs for parts of the robot or things that were they were very specific about. Doug was very particular about the shape of the head, and we actually went through about 5 different iterations of the shape of the head before we nailed what he was really after. But then there were other parts that were left to me to design. A lot of the artwork didn't include feet, didn't include the back, other parts of the body, and so those were left to me to design. Doug really wanted to have a very skeletal look to the whole robot. He wanted to harken it back to the old Jason of the Argonauts skeletons. So we tried to keep everything very gaunt. And in fact, they were bone white to begin with and later changed to a tan. We didn't know exactly what the droid was going to have to do, but we assumed that the battle droid would have to have complete mobility as if it was a human being. And so it had to be able to climb stairs and ladders and do whatever, you know, carry a gun, that sort of thing. And so I wanted to make sure that it could actually function, that knee joints were in the right position, ankles and hips, wrists, hands and arms were really one of those things that you can draw things that look like they work, and then when you actually try and make it work, it might not, so you just adjust it a little bit to make it so that it functions properly. Well, it's a really a neat experience to see something that you've worked on for a long time, and then to actually see it on screen and moving around and interacting with other people and knowing, wow, I worked on that. That was something that I did.
Yeah, I think it's good. I wouldn't do this on all of them.
Okay.
Again, I would say this is the most distressed.
Okay.
The Naboo fighter was the first model I did in the art department for Star Wars. Doug Chang gave me these really, really early sketches of the design, and it was just sort of this teardrop-shaped, very sleek, very, at the time, non-Star Wars kind of looking. Prior to that, all the Star Wars models had been this very boilerplate, exposed parts, you know, panels missing, paint chips, all that sort of thing. And here was something that was sleek and chrome and beautifully smooth painted, like it just came out of the body shop.
Things we haven't really addressed down here is like paint chips and things. Do you want to see that again, or is it okay that it's all?
I think we can keep it pretty much the way it is. I mean, the one thing that I would tone down a little bit is this.
Okay.
Something else that evolved with the Naboo fighter over time was originally the wings weren't as fared into the body. It was part of just the design evolution where I think it looked a lot better once it was all blended together and fared into the body. It just became much more cohesive design. It was so sleek, it had to be very clean. Couldn't have little bumps and lumps and anything. And the tail of it got so thin that it was very easy to just snap off a little piece of it. And I would imagine that by the end of the shooting schedule, that the end of that tail probably lost a good inch or so, because it just kept breaking off little pieces of it as we went.
One of our big things is when they light them, they have to light them extra strong for high-speed photography. And sometimes if you're not watching those folks, you know, your model will melt. So that was sometimes a little bit of a problem. Fortunately, we made copies.
Yeah, oh, I was tremendously proud of it. It was establishing a new look for Star Wars and a whole new world to kind of join into the Star Wars universe. It was really exciting to see, to actually see it flying around, to see it engaging in battles that, you know, were now part of Star Wars history.
Action, fire! I'm behind you!
At last we will reveal ourselves to the Jedi. At last we will have revenge.
Well, the Darth Maul character isn't based at all really on anything in the other movies. I think George Lucas wanted him to obviously have a feel with dark cloak, dark colours, and also quite a lot of talk of sort of samurai warriors and links with the East, the sort of warrior cultures from the East, and the sort of costume that would enable the character to do sort of movements, quite large sort of stunt type fights with some interesting movement in the costume. As soon as you start to move, the fabric sort of spreads out on the top layer, and then underneath it has a sort of a slightly Japanese feel with lots of layers that would in Japan have been sort of armoured layers, and we've done them out of different weights of fabric. He has some prosthetics on his head, and then his whole face is painted. You obviously have to allow for the problems with keeping a hood on a head over the top of horns without causing the actor any discomfort. So we tried to keep the fabric fairly light, but also fairly dense enough to give us a movement, to give us a sort of movement we wanted in for the fight sequences.
George talked about wanting to have a large chrome ship, very Art Deco-ish, fast-looking form. And we had some SR-71 Blackbird models.